So we are all fresh again, I hope. We'll start with a new subject, and this is the final ingredient that we need in order to be able to start with representation theory. What we need is a decent theory of integration on a Lie group. And there are several ways to do this, but one very nice way in the context of Lie groups is by using the differential geometry that is present. Now, of course, we know in the context of manifolds, we know how to integrate. For instance, what we could do is suppose we have an oriented manifold, then we can find a global, say, of dimension n. Then we can find a global n form on the manifold, which vanishes nowhere. And then this n form can suppose that we multiply it with a compactly supported continuous function. Then we get a n form which is compactly supported, and we can integrate. So in this way, we could build an integration theory. Now the drawback of this is that it would be a theory of oriented integration. And really, the kind of integration theory that we are going to do is more is more integration theory related to measures, and that's a non-oriented type of integration. So it's more natural to work with a kind of non-oriented counterpart of volume forms on a manifold. And this is what I'm first going to introduce. So suppose that M is an n-dimensional manifold. And recall that we defined n forms on the manifold, say smooth n forms, as smooth. I mean, we didn't do this, but this would be done in a standard introductory course to differential geometry, to manifold theory. These differential n forms on M are defined, say, as smooth sections of the nth exterior power of the cotangent bundle of M. Now this cotangent bundle, this nth exterior power of the cotangent bundle, is obtained as a set. It is obtained as a disjoint union of the exterior powers of the cotangent spaces. And then this is equipped in a natural fashion, equipped with a vector bundle structure. And then there is a way, if you have a section of this bundle, then and the manifold is oriented, then you could determine its integral, at least if the form is compactly supported. So then there are no convergence problems. And on a compact manifold, there would be no problem whatsoever. Now we're going to do a similar process, but not with exterior differential forms, but by means of so-called densities. And so, just as in the theory of exterior differential forms, one first has to understand what an oriented volume form is on a linear space. So one way to characterize this, suppose V is an n-dimensional linear space over the reals, then one way to characterize the nth exterior power of its dual is as maps that give the oriented volume of a parallelepipeds, that's it, parallelepipeds. If we have a parallelepiped spanned by n vectors, etc., then we would like to assign its oriented volume to it, and this can be done by applying the form to the vectors. So I would like to view this as maps from the nth Cartesian power of V, so V times V n times to R. So the idea is that the spanning vectors of the parallelepiped could be put in the slots here, and one would get the oriented volume. Now, oriented volume should transform as a determinant under coordinate transformations, and one way of saying this is that we require that for all linear maps T, we wish that the pullback of lambda by T is equal to the determinant of to lambda multiplied by the determinant of T. Now this pullback is really defined as lambda composed with T, up to T. So which I'll abbreviate as T lambda composed with T to the n. In other words, take an oriented volume, take a parallelepiped, apply the linear map to the parallelepiped, then the volume of the parallelepiped with respect to this fixed volume form should transform according to the determinant. And this is really a characterization of this nth exterior power. Now, we know that the whole thing about oriented and non-oriented integration is about whether this determinant, this Jacobian factor, appears with absolute values or not. So now we are going to introduce non-oriented volume forms, or so-called densities. The space of densities on V, which I'll denote by dV, is defined in a similar way over there. Maps from the nth Cartesian power of the Cartesian power, Cartesian product of n copies of V to, well, we can as well do it complex valued. And then the requirement is that the pullback under a linear map is obtained by multiplying with the absolute value of the determinant. And this should be true for all linear maps of V to itself. So this is the space of densities on V. And the first observation is that this space is really one-dimensional. Lemma. The dimension has a... So first of all, of course, this is a linear space. This is a complex linear space. And then the dimension over C is 1. Proof is quite simple. What we can do is we can fix a basis of V and then we may consider the map from densities of V to C which maps the density to the value of the density on these vectors E1 up to En. Now clearly this is an injective linear map. Because if this is zero, then it is also zero whatever linear map we apply to these basis vectors. That means that it is zero, that means that it is zero on any sequence of vectors. So clearly this is an injective linear map. It's also surjective because fix, say, a top form in the exterior power, say different from zero, then the absolute value of omega is a density of V, which is different from zero. So what we see is that so we could do this for take the dual basis of E1 up to En. Take omega is E1 up to En, dual basis of E1 up to En. Then what we get is we can look at the image of let this map, let it be denoted by epsilon. Then epsilon of omega, of absolute value of omega, is the absolute value of omega applied to E1 up to En, which is 1. It's a linear map, the image is a linear space, the linear space is non-zero, so it should be the all of C, so indeed this is surjective. By the way, note that omega bar of TE1 up to TEN is just the determinant of T absolute value. So now we can also say, so what is the inverse of this map? Well, we fix this we can write this a bit more, a bit less pedantic and a bit more concretely as follows. D of V is just C times a generator, and the generator may be obtained by taking the absolute value of this exterior product of the double basis vectors. And this is the unique element of the densities determined, so maybe I should call it lambda, by lambda of E1 up to En is 1. Okay. For differential forms, we're now going to define densities on the manifold. Now, for differential forms, we have the notion of pullback of differential forms, which is very important in order to formulate the invariant definition of integration of a volume form. And here we are going to do a similar thing. First, we are going to do it on the level of linear spaces. So suppose that V and W are linear over R of equal dimension. And suppose that A is a linear map from V to W. Then we define the pullback map from densities on W to densities on V just by, as we do it for top order differential forms, lambda maps to lambda composed with the n-fold power of A. And then, so remember that these spaces are one-dimensional, so it's really, this map is either a linear bijection or it's trivial, and it's trivial if and only this map is non-invertible. Well, if this is non-invertible, it means that there is a collapse of directions, which means that if you pull back density, the volume form here, you will get a zero thing there. Okay. Now we are going to lift this to manifolds. So the first thing that we have to introduce is the notion of a density bundle. And then a density of a manifold will be a section of this density bundle. So let's introduce the density bundle. This is going to be the disjoint union of the density spaces associated with the tangent spaces at the points of M. Now this is this can be equipped in a natural fashion with the structure of a complex line bundle. And basically what one does is one uses local coordinates of M. This produces a trivialization of the tangent bundle. Once you have a trivialization of the tangent bundle, you have a trivialization of the density bundle. I'll be a bit more, I'm not going to work this out in all detail, but I'm going to explain what this means in terms of the choice of local frames. So this is a complex line bundle over M. What can we say about the space of sections? Well, suppose sections of this bundle are maps, say lambda, from M to this density bundle with the property that lambda of X belongs to the fiber to the space of densities over X. And what we wish to say is we wish to say when a density is continuous or smooth. And for this, it is sufficient to compare with a certain reference. And now the idea is, suppose that let omega with, well, let's use u with x1 up to xn be a coordinate patch. Then these coordinates introduce differential one forms dx1 up to dxn, and then one knows that for all x, or for all, say, for all a in u, one knows that the this top order form in the point a really is a basis of the nth exterior power of the cotangent space at A. So now the idea is that if we use densities, then we can view this as the complex span of the absolute value of this form. So in this way, we get a map, say, from continuous functions on U, and this is going to be a linear isomorphism. Let's denote continuous functions by a zero, to, say, continuous sections over the set U of the density bundle, given by a function is mapped to f times the absolute value of this top order differential form. And this is a linear isomorphism. And what I should say is that really a section of this bundle is called continuous if in terms of local coordinates it can be expressed in terms of this generating density with a coefficient that is continuous. So really this is defined by using the regularity here. And in a similar way, smooth densities are defined to be those densities for which the coefficient here is a smooth function. So we also have characterization of the smooth densities by the same map. So I hope this is makes clear what a density is. So locally it is like the absolute value of a top order differential form multiplied with a scalar function. So locally you can now see that there should be a kind of integration should be possible. But integration is only going to be possible if locally this can be defined in a coordinate invariant way. So what I'm now first going to do is I'm going to show that if I do integration of compactly supported densities in an open subset of the Rn, then this definition is invariant under the application of diffeomorphisms. And this allows me then to local integration on the manifold, and then by using partitions of unity, I can split up integration and define integration of compactly supported densities on the manifold. That's the idea. Okay, but first I need an operation which is the analog of the operation of pullback on differential forms. So, assume let M and N be manifolds of dimension N. And suppose that phi now is a smooth map between M and N. And now I'm going to define the operation of pullback on the densities, well, rather the space of sections of densities on N. And actually I would like to do this in continuous densities as well, two continuous densities on M. And so starting from a density here, I want to produce, well, a density phi star of lambda. How am I going to do that? Well, let's visualize as follows. Here is M, here is N, here is the map phi. Now suppose that so a point X is mapped to a point phi of X. Now the idea is that if I have a density on the manifold N, it means that at every point I have a density, an infinitesimal density at that point. So that's a density of the tangent space at that point. And then I want to pull it back to a density at this point by composing with the tangent map to the power n. So the pullback of lambda at a point x should be lambda at the pullback under the tangent map applied to the lambda at phi of x. This is the definition of the pullback map. And the mechanism is completely analogous to the mechanism of differential forms. And from this we see that if we start with the absolute value of a differential form, so note that if omega is an n form on n, then what we can do is we can take the pullback of a function times the absolute value of this differential n form, and this will, by following the definitions, one sees that this is the same as f composed with phi multiplied with the absolute value of the pullback of this differential form. Yes. There is the there is the Tx phi, which is between the tangent spaces, and then one pulls back by this map, which means that on the density one composes with the nth power of that map. And this is why I wrote the n there, but I think it's better not to write it there. Yeah. Okay. Now comes the first result, and this is the basic result which allows lifting the integration of densities to manifolds. And this is the following. Lemma or proposition. Let U and V be open subsets of Rn, and let phi be a diffeomorphism. Diffeomorphism from U onto V. Then for First I want to give a definition. U is an open subset of Rn, and assume that lambda is a continuous, compactly supported section of the density bundle over U. So it's a compactly supported continuous density on U. We may write lambda as a function times, and then we take the standard density on Rn. So this is the dual basis of the standard basis. This is the standard density mapping. So this had the property that the sequence of vectors v1 up to vn is mapped to the determinant, absolute value of the determinant of the column matrix consisting of vn, v1 up to vn. Then this can be done with f, a continuous function with compact support on u. And then we define the integral over u of lambda as the Riemann integral of fx over Rn. Of course, this is basically, it basically is an integral over u, because f has compact support in u. But then it can also be viewed as a smooth, compactly a continuous, compactly supported function on Rn by extension outside u.
F to be non-negative,
probably? No. But it's compactly supported. So if you want to define it, say it's Riemann integral, to work with the simplest kind of integration possible, you can choose a huge block such that the support is entirely contained in this block, and then it's iterated integration, if you like. Yeah? The usual thing. Now comes the result that I wanted to write down. Proposition: U and V are open, phi is a diffeomorphism, so maybe I should indicate that by isomorphism in the smooth category. It's a diffeomorphism. Then we have For all densities, continuous compactly supported densities on V, we have that the integral over V of lambda equals the integral over U of phi star of lambda. In other words, integration is invariant under pullback by diffeomorphisms. And this obviously is the first step to extend the notion of integration to the to manifolds. Proof. Well, let's fix. So let's consider the standard basis E1 up to EN, standard basis of Rn. Write lambda as the product of a function times the associated standard density, which has value 1 on the standard parallelepipedate. So f now is a continuous compactly supported function on V. And then we know that the integral over V of lambda is the same as the integral over Rn, or say V, of fx dx. Okay, now let's investigate the pullback of lambda under phi. The pullback of lambda under phi in a point x is lambda. Well, it was the pullback. Was the pullback of f? Maybe just write it like this: the pullback of in a point x. Pullback of f times the pullback of that standard density by means of the tangent map of phi. This is how it works. Now, composing with the n-fold product of this tangent map, one gets the absolute value of the Jacobian outside. So this is equal, and then this in the point x, of course. So this is equal to the f of phi x times the absolute value of the determinant of the tangent map, which in this context is the total derivative of phi, times this one. And so what we see is that the integral of this density is defined as the Riemann integral . So the integral of phi star lambda over u is now equal to the integral over u of f of phi x times the determinant of d phi x times, well, just the usual Riemann integration. So now we have an expression 1. And we have an expression 2, and we know that 1 and 2 are equal by substitution of variables. And this completes the proof. But this means that we now have a way to define integration. Suppose now that let lambda now be a on a manifold, a continuous compactly supported density, then we define the support of lambda as the closure of the set of points where lambda is non-zero. And suppose that this support, and so this support is assumed to be compact, assume that the support of lambda is contained in a coordinate patch u, so in a set u where u comma chi is a coordinate patch. So that means that chi is a diffeomorphism from u to an open subset chi of u of Rn. Now we can define the integral over m of lambda to be, well, we use the inverse of chi to take the pullback of lambda, and then we integrate over the open subset chi of u in Rn. And because of the substitution of variables theorem formulated in that proposition over there, it doesn't matter which coordinates, which chi we take. If we had another coordinate patch with another diffeomorphism chi, then both diffeomorphisms would be defined on the intersection of the two patches. The intersection would still contain the support of the density, and by substitution of variables we would get the same definition of the integral. So this is independent of the choice of chi, and it gives us a local integration theory. And now the idea is to glue these things together by using partitions of unity. So, in general, so I should say that this definition is independent of the particular choice of u and chi, as long as u contains the support of lambda. So now the idea is that now the general situation is as follows. Let lambda be an arbitrary continuous section with compact support of the density bundle on M. So an arbitrary continuous compactly supported density. Then select a partition of unity psi I with I running over an index set such that, so what are the conditions on psi I? Well, let's assume psi I is smooth on M, compactly supported. We may assume that psi I has values between 0 and 1. We may assume that I is finite, and we may assume that the sum over the i's of psi I is 1 on a neighborhood of the support of lambda. And then of course the idea is that lambda can be written as the sum over the i's, I in the index set, of the cutoff function psi I times lambda. Oh, and I should say, of course, I'm sorry, I mean this is the most important thing, that the support of psi I should be contained in a suitable coordinate patch, ui. So then we have that lambda is the sum, the finite sum of the psi I times lambdas, and now this density would be supported in a coordinate patch. And then the integral of lambda over m is defined as the sum over I of the integrals of these. There is a question.
So do you want the support of the psi I's to be compact?
Yes, and I have indicated it by writing the C over there, but thank you. Yeah, supports of the psi I should be compact. So use a partition of unity to localize the density in coordinate patches and then take the integral per patch. Now, of course, there is an argument. One needs an argument to show that this is independent of the choice of partition of unity. Now, but this is a standard argument that you should also have seen in the context of differential forms. Suppose that we have a second partition of unity. So we have one partition of unity and we have a second partition of unity. So let's write it. Let psi I tilde or psi j tilde u j tilde be similar. Then what we need is we need that the sum over the i's of the integral of psi I lambda is equal to the sum over the j's of the integral over m of the psi j tilde times lambda. Now, the proof of this is quite simple, because we know that the integration in coordinate patches is a linear operation. So what we could do is we could rewrite this as the sum over the i's and then write the sum over the j's here and then psi j tilde psi I lambda. Then the summation could be moved out of the integral because this all takes place in one coordinate patch. And then we have a double sum, j and I tilde, of psi, the integral over m, of psi j tilde psi I lambda. But we could do a similar thing here, and then by doing an interchange of summation, one would also have this equality. So by comparison with this common refinement of the partitions of unity, one finds that the integrals are the same. Is this clear? Okay. Good. Now, suppose now that we have a manifold equipped with a smooth left action, then a density, say a continuous density on M, is said to be G invariant if for all elements of the group, if I take the pullback of the density by the action of G, by the left action of G, then the result should be the same density again. Lemma. Important, simple but important lemma. Oh, by the way, I forgot to make a final remark here. I'm sorry. Obviously, this notion of integration of a density on a manifold is invariant under global diffeomorphisms. Right? Because I mean, all structure that has been introduced can be transported under such a diffeomorphism. So, theorem, if M, if phi from M to N is a diffeomorphism of smooth manifolds of dimension N, then for all densities on M which are continuous and compactly supported, the integral over N of lambda is the same as the integral over M the pullback of lambda by phi. Now recall that there is a similar result for volume differential exterior forms on manifolds, but then one has to require, then this is oriented integration, and one has to require that these manifolds are equipped with an orientation and that phi is positively oriented. This is something that we don't have to require here. So this is why this is called unoriented or non-oriented integration. Lemma: suppose that we have such a density. So let omega be a continuous density on the manifold M, which is G invariant. Then the following is true for all compactly supported continuous functions on M. We may integrate and all elements y of the group, we may integrate the product of f and omega over m, and the claim is that this is the same as the result of the integral over m of the pullback by left translation with y of f times omega. Proof: this from M to M is a diffeomorphism, and that means that the left hand side of this expression is also equal to the integral of over M of the pullback of this entire density by left translation with y. That's the result over there. But that this behaves as the product of the pullbacks, so we get the pullback of f times the pullback by y of omega, but now omega is invariant under pullback by elements of the group, and so this is omega. And so we get the right hand side. Okay. Final remark, and then, so this takes 2 minutes and then I'll stop. So now we consider a Lie group G, and then of course we have that G acts by left translation on itself, so the role of the manifold is now going to be played by G. Now, as with vector fields, left invariant vector fields are completely determined by their value at the identity element. Of course, a similar thing is true for left invariant densities. So, what we have is that we could formulate this as follows. And that is that if we look at the continuous densities on G, and we take evaluation at the identity element, then we would get densities at the tangent space at the identity element. So this is the densities on the Lie algebra. If we restrict ourselves to left G invariant densities here, then this will be a linear isomorphism. By G invariance, a G invariant density is completely determined by its value at the identity element. So this is an injective linear map. Conversely, if you have a density on the tangent space, then by using left translation, you get a G invariant density on the group. And what we can do now is, so this shows that we can now fix a non-zero density here, and then transport it to a G invariant density here. So fix a G invariant density dx on G, or a left G invariant density with dx in the identity element is non-trivial. Then it's non-trivial everywhere. And then invariance of integration really means that for all continuous compactly supported functions on the group G and all y in G, the integral over G of f yx dx is equal to the integral over G of fx dx. This should be read as left pullback, take the pullback of f by left translation over y, multiply with dx and integrate that over g. But of course, if you write it like this, it gets a much more pleasant form. Now, the existence of such an invariant density and the invariance of the associated integration on the left translation is something that we are going to exploit next time to show that every finite dimensional representation of a compact group, which is continuous, is also unitarizable. Okay, see you next week.